Good afternoon, above all. Thank you very much to CAF and the dialogue for honoring me with the opportunity to moderate this panel, which is one of the most important one, and people have been awaiting it since the beginning. Two big things have been mentioned that have occurred in our region this year. One, it was the visit of Barack Obama to Cuba and all what that means. And secondly, the peace agreement in Colombia. When I heard Vice President Biden yesterday quoting James Joyce, the great Irish novelist, when he said, "History is a nightmare," which I'm trying to wake up from. And what comes to mind to me is Colombia. The last 50 years of the history of Colombia have been a nightmare for many Colombians. So to start waking up from that nightmare is of incredible significance for Colombia and for the region. And to summarize briefly, this conflict has meant that 200,000 people have died, 6 million people have been displaced, according to the UN, and at least 15,000 people who have gone missing. The conflict has been like chains around the country, preventing it from developing. It's the third most populated country in Latin America. It's a very important country. I think that the region ignored the drama and the conflict in Colombia for many years, partly because Colombia is an introverted nation. They have their mountains and their valleys, and behind those coasts that are protecting and don't let development go in. A conflict that was difficult to understand. It was a vestige of the Cold War, but which became more important thanks to the illegal economies and their boom. And several presidents, almost all the last presidents of Colombia, have tried to end this conflict. And so that is why this agreement, which will formally be signed on September 26, is so significant. I spoke in 2001, 2002 for many hours with Alfonso Cano in El Cagual. He was the political leader of FARC back then. And he was supposed to be a moderate voice, and I was completely depressed after I did that interview with him, because it was very clear that the FARC was not ready to embrace market economy and democracy. So tragically, but necessarily, the military campaign by President Uribe led to having reduced the FARC to reality, gave them a true reality check. And so this is why this peace process has been more serious and successful. They have talked about an impossible triad, a floating rate exchange, and a capital account which is open and free.
Los conflictos.
And in the conflicts, there is also an impossible triad: peace, justice, and truth. So one is in the realm of imperfection. A friend of us all, Malcolm Dees, my fellow countryman, a historian from the UK who has specialized in Colombia, said the other day that this is not the peace that Colombia wants, but it is the peace that Colombia can afford. And the peace that they want, they can't have. And of course, the question of substance here is if the price of peace, if Colombians are going to think that it is worthwhile, that it is, that that price is worth it, to have less than total or less than ideal justice. So they will decide on October 2nd on their plebiscite. Now, to approach this topic and to ask these questions, we have a first-class panel with María Ángela Holguín, who started participating in the negotiations since May of last year, and she's the foreign minister. Then Rafael Pardo, who has participated in several administrations, and now he is the post-conflict minister. Néstor Humberto Martínez, former minister of justice and currently the attorney general of Colombia, and Alejandro Santos, chairman of Reconciliation Foundation of Colombia and director of Semana, which is the most important weekly magazine in Colombia. This panel will leave room for questions. I have the feeling that you have a great deal of questions. So we are going to make this more fluid and dynamic. María Ángela, an easy question. Can you summarize for us the 297 pages of the agreement in only one page? Well, thank you, Michael. Greetings to Enrique Garcia and Michael Shifter for their invitation. And in fact, for all of us, and for all of us, and I speak for all the panelists, it is an honor to be here. The figures cannot be forgotten. Sometimes people forget 8 million victims, missing persons. 50,000 doesn't say much, but if you think it's Chile plus Argentina added together, the number of missing persons is incredible. 7 million displaced people between 2002 and 2016. 4,000 members of the police murdered, and including other armed forces. The unilateral ceasefire distorted reality. For Colombians, we were talking about 400 soldiers dying per year. And this is a situation which in any country in the world and for any person, this needs to be curbed. This needs to be stopped. When our soldiers, when our policemen are killed, and I'm not even including the civilians, but just the law enforcement and the military. So we need to go back to understand where we are coming from. We, from all the presidents who have tried to start a peace process, they talked about leaving the weapons for the votes. And of course, they cannot become a political party and have political representation just because. So why is the agreement important? They're not only leaving their arms behind, and how all the guilty parties will be punished or not, but how can we as a country transform so that what led to this conflict to be maintained and be developed and fester for so many years, it has to change. The country needs to transform itself. It's not just that the guerrillas are going to drop their weapons and leave their guns behind, but the country needs transformation. When we read peace agreements, that is what they have. It's transforming the country at many levels. First of all, the integral rural development. That is where the guerrillas warfare was born. No, everybody is aware of the rural areas that were remote, without services, without roads, without highways, without the population being able to produce things and take them to market in an easy way. So in fact, I recognize that when I arrived at my post in May, I was surprised that the state, that the administration has to come to an agreement with a guerrilla group so that you can provide health and services and drinking water. And when you read the whole issue of integrated rural development is, yes, how can we truly integrate rural people, how rural people can live in the countryside, how can they produce things that they can take to market, how can you provide housing, drinking water, running water. So that's the basic. We have 3 million hectares in 10 years where this is not FARC, where all the peasants who live there. There are no expropriations, and these are lands that have been forfeited from the drug traffickers. These are people, and these are lands that have no titles. And this is what integral rural development means. Colombia is way behind. The rural areas in Colombia need to become a true source of development from our nation. In the second part, which is political participation, we are providing legal security mechanisms so that people are allowed to participate in political parties in different ways. It's not that we are calling to social protests. No, it is guaranteed. People are allowed to express their ideas. It is not being incited or facilitated, but the guarantees are given so that people can speak and speak up. The opposition statute from the year 1991 has been pending with the new constitution. So in many of the aspects that we study, it is amazing that one armed group has been in negotiations to be able to have the state, the administration, do what it has to do. So a ceasefire, reintegration, and these different aspects. But reintegration will be discussed by Rafael because that's his field of expertise. So what happened? We identified a series of areas, or so they will be there 180 days. The United Nations, the political mission through the Security Council, has been asked to be there to support. The observers from the UN are going to be on a permanent basis there from the first to the last day. The international component, that's where the FARC are going to yield their guns, and the guns are not just be lying about, they will become monuments. One monument will be at the United Nations, another one in Havana, and the other one in Colombia, and it is yet to be defined where in Colombia. And the leaving of arms, the laying down of arms will happen through 22 settlements or areas, and that is 300 square meters in the whole country. El Caguan, before the negotiation was started, was 42,000 square kilometers. So when you hear some people say, well, no, you're going to give the country to the FARC, but no, it is 300 square meters. These are districts. These are settlements that have been created ad hoc and will disappear when the laying of a down of arms has finished. So what will happen in those areas? A three-party mission, including FARC, the Colombian Armed Forces, and the international observers will be there for 6 months. There will be a 1 kilometer security perimeter, and then you will have police, national police, protecting people, have to go through a checkpoint, and there will be absolute control of these areas. Regarding point three, there are security guarantees. Of course, it is understandable, but that for FARC, the concern is that they be killed, that their personal security and collective security rights won't be respected. So within the protection unit of the Interior Ministry, a special unit was created to deal specifically with this, to give security to the members of FARC, a security where police, law enforcement, and other groups trained for this purpose will be providing security, and that can reassure the FARC that they won't be killed. Remember UPE in Colombia, that party, the UP, there is a history there. Yes, the central topic is justice, indeed, and that FARC, if they, there are crimes against humanity and other crimes, but they, that some will go into public life directly. If you, like for example, in Peru, in Shining Path, the treatment was different. How can you explain to the Colombians that it is necessary to proceed the way they're proceeding and it is good for the country? Well, if you are going to ask people to lay down their arms and then go to jail, then that is no negotiation. So what have we seen in other processes? Amnesties have not been general. We see all peace processes, and I spoke with the negotiators in Indonesia, said we didn't have that problem because we are not signatories to the international justice. So we need to proceed according to international treaties. There is no amnesty for crimes against humanity, for war crimes. The general attorney, the Attorney General from the Penal Court of Justice said that she agreed completely, and she has been all along explained the process. So where will things truly happen when implementation is carried out? Crimes against humanity won't receive amnesty. There will be a special jurisdiction for peace, and there are three types of sanctions. And the crimes will have 5 to 8 years of effective restriction of freedom, and there will be other jail sentences, and then there will be prison sentences. There will be three different courts, the one with amnesty, the one of recognition of crimes, and another court, which will have information from the Attorney General's office, and that is how the judges are going to be working. So we need to go through a transitional period of administering justice. Yes, otherwise we wouldn't have come to the point of the ceasefire to stop the war and to lay down their arms. So I think we're ahead of many other countries and many other processes, because this is not an amnesty as has occurred in other places. We are right now in a type of justice which is not the one we want. Of course, all Colombians wants to see them jailed, but this is the kind of justice that we can have in order to be able to have peace.
Mr. Humberto Martínez, as Attorney General, you have to convince that you're getting as much justice as possible out of this process. How is this going to work? Is there a special jurisdiction for peace? We don't know exactly how the judges are going to be chosen. Some people have said they would rather not be involved. Now, the role of your office, how is it going to operate to give Colombia the guarantee that there will be as much justice as possible. Yes, Michael. In the special agreements, we decided upon a transitional model of justice that determines the maximum justice possible to be able to achieve peace in a society that wants reconciliation, a model that complies with international standards. And it's not Colombians saying this. It is international organizations. On September 1st, that was said by the prosecutor of the International Criminal Court. And the important thing about that model is that it is designed with a function in mind, which is to avoid all impunity. And here, the role of the Office of the Attorney General is a determining role, and we are going to take this on very mindful of the historical mission that we have been entrusted by our society and by the international community. And that is why we were given the responsibility of delivering reports that will act as a base for the special court to do justice within the model that was just explained. We have more than 100,000 notifications of crime, and that has been accumulated during the conflict. And right from the time when the Office of the Attorney General was established 24 years ago. And we have systematized all that information so that we have good documentation. And in any investigation related to the behaviors that have had the greatest impact on society, behaviors that are war crimes or crimes against humanity, it will be possible to have the special tribunal immediately turn to its task. And here, in the presence of the international community, I want to describe the investigation process of the reports that we'll be turning over to the Peace Tribunal. Regarding the FARC, we will be turning over 8 reports. First, on recruitment of minors. Second, on the odious crime of kidnapping. Third, violence that is gender-based. That is something that tore at the hearts of Colombians. Forced displacement on violations of international humanitarian law, on forced disappearance, homicide, massacres, and on illegal financing arrangements, especially in terms of drug trafficking and FARC and illegal mining. So these are 8 reports that we will be turning over when the special tribunal, the special court, is installed. Also, we have begun our investigation. First of all, looking at false positives. And second, in the area of homicide, this includes victimization and the political movement of democratic leftists, and prosecution, threats to union leaders, massacres, violence that is gender-based, also forced displacement, illegal detention, torture, persecution, and forced migration. Then there are a third type of report that we'll be presenting to the Special Peace Court. Although the jurisdiction defined in the agreements especially emphasizes the way in which third parties intervened. In cooperation, and especially in the funding of paramilitary groups that worsened the conflict in Colombia. So the Attorney General's office will deliver those reports in addition to reports from third parties that cooperated with the guerrillas in Colombia to carry out this armed rebellion. And those who, one way or another, cooperated with agents of the state and that have co-responsibility that cannot go unpunished. So those three components in terms of reports, there we have the commitment to deliver them to the Special Peace Tribunal so that there will be no impunity. And that has to do with the legal termination of the conflict. And now you have to give me a few minutes to tell you what the commitment is on the part of my office to peace in Colombia. But just a few minutes, okay? What does the ordinary courts do? They have to remain vigilant in terms of the present and the future. What does that mean? It means, first, peace throughout the land. Peace in the country requires dismantling criminal bands with a new approach, because there are some guerrillas that have not been demobilized and because there are some criminal organizations that basically base their criminal activities on exploiting the unlawful drug business. And there I am very optimistic. I'm certain that we will be able to have a renewed narco-trafficking policy with the support of all the authorities in the country. And that new approach has to do with capturing and seizing, taking over ownership of this illegal ownership on the part of these unlawful organizations. So after a long struggle against all sorts of criminality and violence that we have experienced during the last 70 years, we have to know that we cannot bend to organized criminals if we cannot get them to bend their knees without submitting them to regular justice. So it's important that there be a commitment to order and legality. Criminals, the capos, even if eliminated, they reproduce like rabbits. As soon as we remove one person, there are several coming in to take that person's place. Now, they will be judged by the general courts of Colombia, and we will be able to put an end to the illegal holdings of all these organizations. That will apply to FARC. Would that be the unlawful possessions of the FARC? It may be in financial investments, for example. Not necessarily is it in the field. Yes, of course, Michael, and in a categorical way, because in addition to peace in the land, the Attorney General's office will call for peace and democracy. Our violence, Michael, originates from political violence. Our country has a very young fabric. Our institutions go back only 200 years, and it has been engaged in fratricidal wars, struggling over power. And now we have opened up a space where we'll be able to fight over power, but power in democracy. And so we welcome those that demobilize if they come into democracy and follow the lawful rules of political competition. The FARC will not do politics in Colombia with illegal fundings stemming from drug trafficking, kidnapping, extortion, and blackmail. And I want to say that in my visit here to Washington, I have been able to enter into a great partnership with the authorities of this country to establish working groups that will allow us to take over control of these unlawful properties belonging to the FARC. And since you are a columnist, I know that you're probably asking me, do you have evidence on that? And the answer is yes. So through that 100,000 reports and notifications, you're acquainted with crimes against the people, right? But do you know about the size of this unlawful patrimony? Do you have the necessary information? Michael, we have so much information that for our, the success of my investigation, I'm going to deprive you of an answer. That is fine. That is great. Very well. Thank you. Now, Rafael. No, no, no. One final point, Michael. Peace and democracy means not allowing corrupt monies to be present in Colombian politics. We have to build a political system that is completely new, Michael, and there money from kidnapping, from drug trafficking, from corruption cannot contaminate the hopes of our new generations. Here, too, we have agreed upon a bilateral agenda in banner cases where we have been able to identify situations where corruption, and we have already identified those situations in Colombia, but where some of these people also were involved in the United States laundering their assets. And I am pleased to say that the Attorney General of the United States has given priority to those cases for criminal investigation in such a way that we can tell the people who are corrupt that their days are limited.
Muchas gracias. Ahora sí, Rafael.
Thank you. Now I'll call on Rafael. Rafael, you too have a complicated task ahead. All experts point out that establishing security and the impact in the country is very important in that first year. So you have a development agenda for these very remote areas that are very poor, that are lacking and that have been affected by this conflict. I know that you have many programs, projects, different lines of work, but in a very succinct fashion, how can you establish peace and the presence of the state in those territories? Thank you, Michael. I'll begin by thanking Enrique and Michael for their invitation. And I wanted to say that it's The Economist who knows how much money the FARC have. The Economist published that information.
For those of you, the few who do not read The Economist, let me tell you that we did publish a report that the government didn't even know existed, but from a report of theirs. But thank you, Attorney General, for telling this to us. Yes, maybe that could be the key. Well, anyway, once the agreements have been signed, there will be three priorities with different timelines and which are also essential. The first one is to ensure stabilization of the areas where the FARC are located, because the FARC won't be there anymore within 3 weeks, more or less, give or take. And in those regions, which according to the Ministry of Defense are 101 municipalities, they will require stabilization. And for that, there needs to be strengthening of the military and police forces and an immediate development program, which is called quick response, and it's not really structural. In 1 year, you cannot work on the structural aspects, but you can improve the presence of the government, and you can establish mechanisms of mediation and justice, improve the rural roads, and you will be able to establish more accessible credit mechanisms than those that currently exist for the agricultural area. And the quick response plan, as far as the civil government is concerned, is for $1.2 million. And it is the dollar in dollars, in US dollars, depending on the exchange rate today. So $400 million, so 1.3 billion pesos. A second priority is to fulfill the agreements. It's not second because it's less important, but because the timeline is longer. Each line of the 297 pages of the agreement, each paragraph, leads to a series of commitments that have to be kept. Essentially, or 99%, or basically, it is related to the displaced rural population and not related to people who are currently members of FARC. These are programs to give opportunities in a more balanced way, opportunities for better quality of life in the rural areas, and a program which is for 10 years. For building, for example, a modern system for land registry and cadastre. So on the one hand, you have a literary deed that you take to a notary public, then you take it to the register and registrar, and then you have the cadastre, where you have the physical description of the lot, and they do not communicate. But what shows or demonstrates per, ownership is the deed. 65% of rural properties in Colombia do not have a status in land ownership, and that is legal for land holding. So this multi-purpose plan is aims to reach those 2.5 million rural lots, where we make sure that the title agrees with the boundaries of the lot, and we have 6.5 years to do this in order to include the 12.5 million lots. So we need to also improve social security in the rural areas, because the situation in the rural areas is abysmally different than what it is in the urban areas. In the economic system, where there are employers and employees, in the rural areas, most are independent producers. They are farmers, and they have no social security. And there are 5 million workers in the rural areas. About 500,000 of them have access or coverage with social security. So the deficit is gigantic. Let me give you an example to see how we have problems with social security. Coffee has been, for 120 years, the dorsal column of Colombia and its economy. So the coffee growers, when they go to sell their harvest, their crop, they use their phone, their cell phone, to check prices in Hamburg. But less than 20,000 of them has social security. Of the 500,000 of them, the average age of the coffee grower is 57 years of age, because they do not retire. They cannot retire because they do not have a pension system to protect them in their older age. So they have no protection if at the age of retirement, and there is no way in which the new generations, those younger coffee growers, will be able to begin to start production. And this is coffee, which is the symbol of the rural growers of Colombia. So this was the this a kind of protection for the rural people will take at least 20 years to be accomplished. There are 130 programs at least that derive from the peace accord. The third point is that it is not only an issue of infrastructure and services provided by the state and services provided by the state, but also the private sector needs to change their geography of action. They haven't had a broader geography of action because of the conflict. So in order to broaden their scope of business, then we are currently designing, and this will be implemented after the powers given to the president, after the plebiscite takes place, then first a relocation of manufacturing plants to provide fiscal incentives to products coming from areas that have been in the conflict zone, also hiring people who come from specific regions, and fourth, exchange of taxes for work for those companies that may like that model. Also, so we needed to comply with the accords and to have a transformation of the rural area and the rural economy in the country. There is another issue. We are going to have the FARC concentrated in these different settlements, and those areas also have the paramilitary, and there is a very corrupt political class that has not been taken to court as yet. But well, it cuts both ways, but yes, you have to deal with it inside too. So who is going to be the boss? You will have the Roman consuls who go from the center and go to the remote areas. Oh, you will have prefects? No. Their name is not prefects. I think I like the name, but the system will be decentralized, and in which the nation is responsible for implementing the agreement, but there are other responsibilities in development programs, and these are 10 to 20 years out. There is also, these are 10 to 20 year programs. We have the flat contract for decentralization, where we have the responsibility of the central government, of the department governments, and municipal governments within a period of 10 years. This is the mechanism. There are not envoys coming from Bogota going to develop the regions, but through broad community participation and with a mechanism that is essential for all the agreements, so that there be transparency and that all the projects will be not under the table but on the table, and everything will be included in one single instrument, one single document, one single vehicle, which is the plan contract, the blanket contract. And this is the way in which it will be articulated. It is not through envoys. No, it is done locally. So there has to be broad participation by the local level, the municipality, the department, et cetera. Alejandro, there is a small issue here, and it is that Colombians have to approve this on October the 2nd through the plebiscite. So tell us, we have seen surveys that give us great range and variation. The consensus today seems to dictate that there is a great deal of support for the yes. But how do you see the plebiscite? What is the opinion, the public opinion? Where is it right now? So if the yes wins, how do you see the situation? Yes, thank you.
I wanted to thank both Enrique and Michael for their invitation. And I would say that the first thing is that we have to understand that turning the page on war in a country is not an easy task. And in that regard, I think it's important to understand the mood that can be expressed by a country in that transition. On one hand, there's fear. Many sectors fear change. They're afraid of the future. They are afraid of there being a leftist populist taking power, and they look in the mirror and see Venezuela. So this becomes a fear that can be personified, and that creates a fright. But there's also a hope, a collective hope that we are going to leave a dark chapter, a chapter that has traumatized us for more than 50 years in Colombia, behind. The figures that were given to you by our foreign minister, that Michael gave you, are dramatic numbers. And here, what Stalin said applies, saying that one death is a tragedy and 1 million deaths is a statistic. The thing is, here we're looking at statistic, but what has happened in that country for 50 years admits no label. And I think that Colombia, with the signature of the peace agreement, definitely moves into the 21st century, leaving behind the heavy burden of the past century, the armed conflict. And in that context, what lies ahead is not going to be easy. One thing is a political negotiation between a government and an armed group, an unlawful group like FARC, working in Cuba. And another very different thing is reconciliation of the country on its own land. Now, also, there is strong polarization. There is a great deal of sensitivity. This is a country full of scars and stigmas and fears, and also with interests, with different electoral agendas, and now with social media, people are in the trenches. And so this becomes a very complex mixture. And that cocktail, that pressure cooker that we are currently feeling in Colombia, is going to go through a process, which is the plebiscite. And that will lead to a result. And there, the Colombians will be able to exercise all of this rage that's contained and all of their hopes in this plebiscite. And here, and I think that a yes vote will win, but it's important that the consolidation of peace be very legitimate. And so a majority vote for the yes is highly desirable. But here we begin to see some split. One thing is the agglutinating nature of peace, and I think that that will be reflected in the vote on October 2nd. And the other thing is the friction that lies ahead as we implement peace, because one thing binds people together, but once we accomplish that, tensions will be created. Segmentation will occur. And this leads us to a question. When people say, okay, what comes next? What is post-conflict? We talk about post-conflict, and I would try to summarize that in the following way. Post-conflict is only trying to integrate the land that has not been reached by economic and social development in Colombia. These are marginal lands, and that is not an easy task, and that is the big task that lies ahead in Colombia for the next 20 years. Many of the agreements mentioned by the foreign minister, especially when she talked about the rural lands, it's important that Colombia do something that has not been capable of. For example, the minister was talking about the cadastre in Colombia, where food is a great issue. This is an irony and a paradox. But beyond those challenges and beyond the matters of security that was mentioned by the general attorney, we have armed groups that were financed with illegal mining, with coca crops. And I think then that a lot of the challenge, because it is the challenge of peace, the real challenge is precisely that. And the way that we face that challenge is essential. And here, I would put it in the following words. I think that the key element for our building a peace that will be stable and long-lasting is not only through the presence of the state, which is a natural, obvious, irreplaceable answer. That is obvious. We all recognize that. But in a region that is so fragile, that is so easily controlled by local mafias, that has to be taken into account. But for the state to have a degree of legitimacy, and yesterday Vice President Biden said, for the light to come on and shed light in these remote corners of our country, we need civil society to play a determining role in building up this peace. And here, I have been invited, not because I am the director of the Semana Weekly, but because I belong to a foundation called Reconciliation Foundation of Colombia. And it aims at creating a big platform where civil society can work collectively, strengthening the social fabric of the territories, having a high impact on the reconciliation of the country. So try to understand if we as civil society can work collectively so as to try to have an impact in that reconciliation, especially in those areas that have been victims of violence. So that role where civil society has to begin to play a key role, working at the side of the state, is key. And in addition to that, there's another determinant, and that is the role of the private sector. That is absolutely crucial. In a country where we have the paradox of being a middle-income country, with the idea of joining the OECD in 2 years, and at the same time have territories that are back in the 16th century and have an armed conflict, we have companies that have more than 60,000 employees. In a company in Colombia, it could be El Éxito. You could put all the FARC members, all of their support network, you could put them all to work in that one company. And that's a paradox. That is something that did not occur in the Central American countries. It wasn't the case in the African conflicts. There, they had a very vulnerable private sector, but our private sector in Colombia is strong, it's powerful, and we have important SMEs. So that player from the private sector working hand in hand with civil society has to play a determining role in establishing this lasting peace. It's not a matter of just sending the police or judges out to the region. That isn't the answer, and that has been a big mistake. If we do not provide the necessary conditions for private sector, large, intermediate, and large, to invest in tourism, in industry, in energy, we've been talking about energy, for us to begin to create jobs and wealth in territories, this is going to be very hard. Plus, a civil society with social organizations, with community communications, mechanisms so that we can turn on the lights in these regions where, in the dark, these dark groups have arisen. Well, I apologize, but I go back to the plebiscite, because we know in my country that when you ask one thing, sometimes people answer something else. They answer saying, I don't like this or I don't like that. And in Colombia, the Colombians are not very satisfied with a lot of things right now. What happens if the no wins? The president said there is no plan B. You're the only person here that doesn't work for the government. So you're free to speculate. What would happen if the vote is no? If it's no, it would be a big frustration trying to foresee a scenario where in the vote, the country would say no. I think that that would have a tremendous psychological effect, especially inside a country that has suffered violence it would be sending a message that we're not capable of overcoming that political violence that has not only been going on for 50 years, but even longer. And then second, we would be sending a very complicated message to the international community. And I think that the economic backlash would be very strong. For example, in the last 2 weeks, there have been two people that manage important funds that have called me. These are people that know me well. They've called me and they have asked me that question. What happens if the no wins? They're calling me. People with investments in Colombia are getting nervous. What does that mean? What can happen? So just in terms of management of expectations, it's a very complicated thing. Now, without talking of the possibility, I repeat, the possibility of not reaching an agreement with the FARC, and I think that that is very high, so that the government would begin to run out of oxygen. This is a government that has wagered putting its bets on peace. And there, the possibility is that the armed group would not see any clarity on the horizon, any legal, political clarity. And consequently, in a complicated country like Colombia, they would not be willing to enter into a democratic system. And the worst thing that could happen in Colombia is for us to begin another 50 years of violence. Okay, we have a short time for questions. I'm going to be quite controlling here. These have to be questions and not comments. Questions have to be short. So please give your name, say if you're addressing your question to one specific person, and please be very brief. I'm Jesus Abreu, and I'm a Venezuelan student here in DC. We heard one person who is not part of the government and saying what would happen. I would like to hear from the government officials what would happen if the vote is no. We heard from a person who is not part of the government.
I am Peruvian. I have suffered terrorism from Shining Path, and I have been Minister of Defense in my country. I wanted to ask you, given the advantages that are being offered and concessions that the peace agreement is offering to the members of FARC, and the attempt to justify those concessions, how will you explain, if the agreement is approved, to regular criminals that are in jail due to theft or robbery, they have to do their time? So how are you going to justify this, and how are you going to explain it to the Colombian society? Because these people won't have to go to jail, not even one day, but they will go into politics and being financed and funded by all Colombians. Thank you. Yes, Marcelo Jesus, I am from Argentina. Two very short questions. First, I infer from what the Attorney General says that is the patrimony or the property of FARC is not part of the agreement, and is there going to be an assessment of the type of arms that will be laid down by the FARC? Yes, Minister. Yes, to the Venezuelan student, what will happen? I think Colombians have an appointment with history right now. And when we hear all the criticisms and the voices against, curiously enough, they come from people who have lived in the war in a relative way. They have not experienced it firsthand or deeply. If I remember the 28th of August, the 29th, the ceasefire was announced. There was a broadcast in municipalities that have been very well very deeply affected, Cabrera and Cundinamarca, Toribio. El Caguán, and people were jumping up and down. They were happy that they will finally have an opportunity. And this is what I feel people need to be given an opportunity to live in a country that is in peace. Of course, and I speak for myself, it's easier from your comfort where you live. It's easy to say no to peace. But people in Colombia who have lived through war, people in those little hamlets, people, rural people, the victims themselves, the victims are the ones that are calling for peace. It's not given the opportunity to a country to have a different chance in life, different chance to life. And I think this could become very complicated. And I don't want to compare, of course, with your country, but when you don't give the opportunities to people to have a different life, this can lead to things that can become even worse. And please understand what I'm hinting at. And I think this is an opportunity that has to be given to the people who have suffered under the war. And yes, could you please now answer, because some of the questions were addressed to you too. Two replies. I am a judicial operator, and the mandate of the Attorney General is to administer or to apply the law. The judiciary, it follows the law and interprets the law, and the constitutional court of my country has forbidden me from proselytize one way or the other. I cannot be either for or against regarding the plebiscite, but I can give you a few comments on about the situation from the perspective of legge data. In other words, what the regulations would be, how this would affect the regulatory aspects. Of course, the property of the FARC was not legalized in the agreement. I am surprised that this is not mentioned at all in the debates on either position, on either side. While those of us who are acquainted with the way in which the negotiation took place, and we were aware of the amnesty procedures, we learned proposals from the insurgents so that money laundering would be connected to the political crimes, and with great integrity. And I want to publicly recognize the president of Colombia, who listen to the Attorney General's office, and according to his own values and with great integrity, prevented this from being one of the decisions that were to be included in the amnesty project. In the version that was published in the final accords, the 297 pages, there is no mention whatsoever of money laundering as connected as a crime to the political crimes. And in addition, the government negotiator was taken to the point where he established directly that the property that had been obtained illegally would be part of the asset forfeiture. And this is an equivocal direction for judges. So when we're talking about this and working with international cooperation, we follow the rules for this transition. And I'm also surprised that the community is not illustrated about the issue of drug trafficking. In a discussion that is taking place in my country these days about the intensity of penalization against illegal crops, we have to say that the agreements did not capitulate vis-a-vis the intentions of FARC, that it were not possible to use aerial fumigation to eradicate the crops. Further to that, it is included in the text as an option to destroy illegal crops. We don't have plan A or plan B among the judges, but we have the duty to have a constant line to repress all types of crime, and we are prepared for the situation, whatever it may be, that occurs after the plebiscite. Is there an inventory of the arms that are being laid down? Yes, the Ministry of Defense has a long, detailed list. I have seen it in other cases, in other peace process, where the Ministry of Defense has accurate inventories of the weapons owned by FARC. In response to the former minister of Peru, Mr. Montesinos sent once a cargo of weapons for FARC, and that is included in that inventory. So what I'm saying is this. You say that the size of sanctions and sentences vis-a-vis other crimes, regular ordinary crimes. But in the abstract, it's easy to talk. Criminal code, who was the first? A Hammurabi code? Yes, from the very first code. It says the worse the crime, the worse the time, and the worse the sentence. I have had a history. And this has been random. I didn't look for this, but I have participated in peace processes. That one we had with M19, MPL, Popular Militia, and all these other groups. And the legal instrument we had back then was indultation and pardon due to these crimes. There was no transition. It was a mechanism of pardon. And a great deal of the criticism that was given at that point in time to those people who have demobilized and have been 25 years demobilized, and they kept saying these people committed crimes, but they are in Congress, they have become mayors, they have become governors. It is a hard thing to talk about. At another point in time, I influence the policy of law compliance by the drug traffickers. So in other words, those who came to justice on their own accord would have lower penalties imposed on them, and they would have shorter sentences. And this is part of our code. These discussions are very difficult. What is the difference now? The issue is not what my opinion is or what your opinion is, but what the opinion of the Colombia people is. If they think they agree that the penalties are not given or that they be of a certain duration, this is a democratic decision by the people. It's not my opinion or your opinion. Yes, thank you.
Sí, gracias. No soy filósofa.
I'm not a philosopher, but I wish Colombians the very best. I would like to know your opinion regarding the following. To obtain pardon, you need to repent and not any conditions. Thank you. Up here, Jose Miguel. Can you hear me? Thank you for this opportunity and for this excellent panel. I have a couple of questions. Ms. Holguín, in referring to the agreement, says that there will be no prison for those confessing their crimes, even if they're not war crimes, but that there will be effective restriction of freedoms and liberties. And that is correct. My question is, amongst those effective restrictions on rights, is exercise of political rights included? In other words, war criminals, once they confess, while they are being sanctioned, can they run for office? Can they participate? Can they hold some of the seats in Congress that have been reserved for the FARC? And my second question goes to the Attorney General. It's a legal question. What I don't understand is, what is the legal basis being used to justify the expansion of these concessions, these benefits, to agents of the state? In other words, to the generals that have not been processed because of false positives, because you understand that there is transitional justice when the counterpart is, for example, laying down arms or disarmament. But in the case of military personnel that committed atrocious acts, what is the legal justification you use to justify those benefits when there is absolutely no transition? Thank you. Okay, I think that we have quite a bit to answer, so let's stop the questions here. So, Madam Minister, in the case of participation in politics, people that have been accused of crimes against humanity, that is something that HIAP will be deciding case by case. That will be the judges of HIAP, depending on each case and depending on the type of penalty. They're the ones that will decide on that participation. Thank you, Jose Miguel. First of all, the judiciary did not negotiate this agreement. So when you ask what is the legal basis for those rules, I could not answer because I wasn't part of the negotiation. But I would say that from what you can read in reading the text, an effort has been made to establish symmetry in the way that the authors of the conflict are treated. And that is a premise that pervades all of the rules laid out therein, precisely to bring an end to the conflict. Because otherwise, with asymmetrical treatment, where in the past, for example, in terms of the reinsertion of a very belligerent group, M19, it caused a lot of damage, and it received a very ample and generous pardon that was universal in nature. There, the actors in that conflict wound up being processed by the ordinary justice system, and many of them are in jail and will be there for some time. Now, those asymmetries create in the heart of the citizenry a new seed of conflict. Part of what happened back then shows that there was very asymmetrical, very different treatment in the way that the state gave pardons to some but not to others. And so people in Colombia feel that those who took up arms to rebel against the powers of the state were given such a broad amnesty. And those that were defending the public authorities and the citizens armed by the state are behind bars. And that is what the country does not want. That is the way that I interpret it, but I cannot assure you that that is the reality of the feelings towards those agreements. There was something about atonement, about repentance. The question was, there can be no pardon without repentance, and that sounds very fine, but sometimes when you hear about the conflict and what the war has been like in the country, and you hear from the victims and the victimizers that are repentant, the way of giving a pardon is so personal, it's so unequal, so uneven, that it's hard to really understand the process. And the same can be said about how reconciliation is viewed. One thing is what the Afro communities think about reconciliation in the country. That goes back some 500 years. Another thing is what the indigenous peoples think, depending on the region and the country. So the conflict is a whole gamut of shades of gray, where we have a great mixture of things. So any process is going to take time. How can we begin to heal? How can we heal what already happened in the past without forgetting it? And here I think that one of the key points is going to be if Colombia is able to maintain the memory of what happened alive and at the same time look forward to build a more civilized, more modern, better country, because memory involves phantoms and flaws. So I think that the matter of memory and how much we can look ahead, all of that is important when you're trying to understand pardon. One final round. Marta Lucia, I apologize, but you got a question yesterday, and you can ask your questions in Bogota to the members of the panel. So I am going to call on people who have not had a chance. So we have people here, here, and here, one towards the back. Good afternoon, Chapi Ruth Castro from Harvard University. I supported the yes, and I'm going to vote yes. But I wonder about the same thing that all entrepreneurs are asking. Have they estimated the economic value? What is it going to cost Colombians to vote yes or to vote no on October 2nd? Here and then in the back. Right here and then in the back. Cristina Folmer from Ureli. I'm from Venezuela. What impact do you think peace will have on the political chaos that we have in Venezuela? The consolidation of this country as a narco state and a possible human tide that may spill over the borders into Colombia. Good afternoon, Carlos Guillen Plazas. First of all, I wanted to thank Minister Pardo, the Foreign Minister Holguín, Mr. Santos, and also the Attorney General. I want to thank you for all we have learned. You have been able to clarify many of the doubts that your fellow citizens have. Every day I go to work and I listen to the media from my country, and I feel 100% proud of my country. And on the way home, I do the same thing. So I find that there is tremendous diversity of opinion. So it's like the country is polarized. And that is something that is part of democratic life in Colombia. So I'm not asking about the diversity of opinion, but I do want to ask all Colombians, why don't we build peace and do so in peace? Well, there's always tension between representation democracy and participatory democracy. But yes, Marta Lucia, OK. I've been told that you can ask a question. Well, first of all, I think that this is the first time that in a forum there's censure, but we have to get used to it. Then regarding the questions, the Attorney General said in his very interesting presentation that there is no risk of the FARC doing politics with narco-traffic money. I would like to ask, what is the definition of that sanction, the restriction of freedom expression. That does not exist in the Penal Code of Colombia. Yesterday, there was a question about money from drug trafficking. Is it explicit in the agreement? It's not. So you're going to have to find out where the money from drug trafficking, from extortion and kidnapping is, because there's definitely a big asymmetry for those who are engaged in politics and we want political life to be clean, and the tremendous resources of FARC would have a negative impact. Now, regarding justice, in Colombia's Constitution, in Article 162, it says that anyone accused of any crime related to rebellion cannot participate in politics. Article 36 says that anyone who has been sentenced has no type of impediment to participate in politics. So that agreement is reforming the Constitution, and that entry into the political arena is what creates a concern for many, because we think that when politics are done with the advantage of illegal funds plus state resources that will be assigned as part of our multi-year budget over a 20-year span, of course there are concerns. And we want peace. All of us want peace, but we also want democracy. You referred to how important justice is, and I am referring to the importance of justice, a state of law, and democracy. Very well, then. Would you all respond?
Yes, Rafael. I would like to refer to two of the questions, the one from Venezuela and the one regarding costs. With or without the peace agreement, there is a major concern in Colombia regarding the implications of a collapse of the Venezuelan political system in terms of the number of people from Venezuela who will migrate to Colombia seeking refuge. And this has been seen in those particular cases where people have been authorized in agreements for the weekend, for example, and in other at other times on a continuous basis for Venezuelans to be able to go into Colombia to buy items in border areas. So there is a great concern that with or without the peace accord, there is a situation that is concerning to us all. Secondly, regarding costs, what I have talked about, what I mentioned in my first set of remarks, has there is a set of costs for the short term that are established. In the 10-year plan, our estimates need to be tweaked regarding the needs of resources and costs in terms of costs of how much will it cost to have the FARC coming back to society. These are costs that will be disbursed next year. So this is how the agreement is implemented. Otherwise, we will have the same situation. We know how much is the cost of bombs, military action, and we can, of course, compare those costs, the war costs, with peace costs. But peace comes with a price, any cost, and it is a cost that the Colombian society can afford is much better than not having peace. And this is what makes sense for me and what I am conveying to you. Yes. I think the question was more for the Attorney General, but or what other? Well, the Venezuela issue, well, I completely agree with Minister Pardo. With or without the peace, the situation in Venezuela is very complicated and challenging for Colombia. We are monitoring it on a regular basis what has happened at the border. Is clear, it's open for the Venezuelans to be able to go across and buy. And I want to thank Alicia from ECLAC. She has worked with us to take a look at two different economic models that are so different, and we're trying to coexist with them. But I think this is regardless of the peace agreement. The situation is there with or without the accord. A footnote to the taxes issues, and yes, and I agree with Mr. Pardo that war is more costly than peace, not only financially, but of course in human lives. We tend to forget what this means in the lives of those who are poorer and more vulnerable. So let's keep that in mind. What the other thing is that in these issues, well, yeah, taxes tend to always go up, and we saw it at the forum. Today we have heard about taxes and what is in the offing, and that in these transitions, in exceptional measures with tax incentives, I think that tax incentives are essential in certain areas of the country to begin to generate income through tourism in areas where nobody goes and where the landscape is beautiful. These incentives, where the private sector will invest, become something basic and essential. I have two answers. First, related to political intervention today, and the Constitution, through the framework for peace, forbids those who have been convicted due to rebellion to be excluded, or forbids them to be included in society. But that's exactly what is included in the plebiscite, and it entails constitutional reform. So how are they going to be able to work in politics, and what conditions will they be able to do politics in? We need to do a series of definitions that will be carried out by Congress. This is the rehabilitation of the rebels won't happen automatically. It will have to be in compliance with the law and with the Constitution. This is very important. We will need to create political consensus in order to define how the rebels would be able to participate in politics. And again, this is from the Legge Ferenda regarding the assets and property of FARC. There are some technicalities, but the first thing is that, of course, illegal, illicit property was not legalized. This is clear. You could say, well, would it be desirable that from the standpoint of organizing land that the guerrillas would have contributed their own land as reparation for the victim, which is part of the special agreement. This is not included in the text of the agreement, but what does appear, and this is the high responsibility of this Attorney General's office, to include that with all the asset forfeiture of all the lands, and this is explicitly written in there. And we hear in certain sectors that FARC wanted to have their lands be exempted from asset forfeiture. But we need to inform you here that these assets, the so-called assets of FARC, do not belong to them. They were abandoned lands, and I'm talking about over 6,000 hectares that were illegally held by FARC, out of which 550,000 have been expropriated through a significant action carried out through the superintendency of registrars, and so they cannot be titled to settlers as long as the ownership titles of those lands are changed. And there is another issue there. Since their property is illegally held, and there is no special regime in the peace accord, so if we're going to go after those illegal assets, what they cannot do as soon as the amnesty kicks in, they can no longer make those assets appear as legal, because they will always be illegal. They will never be legal lands, and they will always be illegally held. So let me be clear, if they try to pretend that their lands were legal, or they try to launder those assets, they will be committing new crimes. And at that point in time, the privileges granted to them by amnesty will be lost. Thank you. Thank you very much. This is the end of our forum, and I would like to thank the panelists as well as all of you for your participation.